Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio with your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Today we have back on the show with us, Chris Shelton. Chris, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you. Glad to be back.
Now, Chris, you were in the Sea Org for a long time. How many years?
25 years.
From what year to what year?
From 1995 to, 27 years, actually. 1995 to 2012, end of 2012.
So 27 years.
Yeah.
What I want to, Chris, what I wanted to explore today, first of all, I want to begin with this Sea Org recruitment cycle. How does that happen? How are you personally recruited into the Sea Org?
Well, I had a number of recruitment interviews through the years, starting actually from the first year that I joined staff as a regular, local Class 5 church staff member. I went down to Los Angeles for training, and they sat me down, and while I was there to train and then go back to my org, to Santa Barbara, but that they'll recruit anybody anywhere anytime. There's no stops on any of that, right? So they would sit me down for hours and talk to me about how great the Sea Org was and that sort of thing, and this happened about over the years about 4 or 5 times. And I always sort of resisted. I didn't really want to do it. And
now, and just to interject, so our listeners understand, staff and Sea Org are two different religious orders within the church.
Exactly. That's right. I was a Class 5 staff member, and they, of course, have a lot more freedoms than the Sea Organization, which is considered the sort of Scientology's monastic order, in the order of monks, right?
Well, could you go through now? Staff is classed by the church itself in legal documents as a religious order. So, as I understand it, you can join staff for either 2.5 years or 5 years, correct?
That's correct. That's right.
And you sign a contract.
That's right. You do. You are contracted staff. That's another way they call it, contracted staff.
But you understand that you're not an employee.
Oh no, that's right. It's all volunteer. It's all the pay and everything is the contract and everything. It's all acknowledged that you're a volunteer of the church.
Okay. Now, what I wanted to ask you, when you signed your staff contract, what year was that?
1987.
Okay. So, did you sign for 5 years?
I did. Initially, I did. Yeah.
And when you sign. Once you sign your staff contract for 5 years, do you then sign another contract with whatever church you're going to work for?
Well, if you change, yeah. I mean, I signed up with Santa Barbara, and so that's where I'm – go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. So your staff contract is between you and the Santa Barbara Class 5 org?
That's exactly right. I was recruited initially to be on staff when I was 17 years old by Santa Barbara org. Or the Church of Scientology of Santa Barbara, and they signed me up, and then I was, contracted volunteer for Santa Barbara, and while I was doing that, while I was fulfilling that contract is when I, went down to Los Angeles for training, and that is when the Sea Org grabbed me up, and the recruiters wanted to recruit me, very straight away.
Hey, question on the side,
yeah.
Chris, when you're Santa Barbara org, did you ever meet Reed Slatkin?
I did. I actually went to his house.
Really?
Yeah, I went to his house once or twice as well. Him and his wife, Mary Jo, their kids. He was never on services in Santa Barbara org, but his wife and I think one of his sons was at one point.
Now, Reed Slatkin, back then, was a very wealthy public Scientologist.
Mm-hmm. Lived in Hope Ranch, which was the wealthy area of Santa Barbara.
That is amazing. Well, we'll get back. We'll come back around to Reed Slatkin,
sure,
because that is a story in itself when that thing blows up in the church.
Yeah.
Okay, so now, when I go down L. Ron Hubbard Way here in Los Angeles by Big Blue or what's called Pack Base, there's a Sea Org recruiting chapel. I'm sorry, right by the chapel, there's a Sea Org recruiting office.
Yes, the Senior HCO recruiting office, yes.
What a fancy name, Senior HCO recruiting office.
Yes.
What is the HCO?
Hubbard Communications Office, and that's the division of the organization that's responsible for establishing it and running its communication. All the communications, the mail, the phones, internal dispatches, the telexes they receive, all of that stuff is physically handled by HCO, the Hubbard Communications Office, and they are also responsible for the establishment of the entire organization, which means they're the guys who do recruitment.
So they recruited you. Is it intimidating to be asked to sign a one-billion-year contract?
Yes, it scared the hell out of me, which is why I didn't do it for so many years. I didn't want to have anything to do with that. I thought I had my hands full, you know, with 5 years. And I ended up re-signing that five-year contract four times. I didn't do 20 years, but, you know, the way it worked is very briefly here, because I don't want to get into all the complexities of this,
sure.
But basically when I signed up, when they send you off for training and they train you full time like they did with me, where I went to Los Angeles for special course supervisor training, when you come back from that training, having successfully completed it, that's the date that your contract actually starts for the 5 years.
So they don't count the training.
That's right. And so that's per a policy on the technical training course. So so you basically sign it newly when you get back from your training. And during the course of time that I was on staff in Santa Barbara, I went off for full-time training four times.
So does your contract stop during training periods?
You're still on contract, but you know that when you get back from your training, you're going to be signing a new one.
They just are not going to. So, like, if you go to if you go for training for 3 months,
yep.
Just pick a unit sign, and you come back, you have to sign a new 5-year contract.
That's correct.
If they reset the clock with every training?
Yeah, basically, yes.
You can't win. They
got
you coming and going.
That's right. They, in fact, that became a real issue in the last few years with the Golden Age of Tech stuff, with Golden Age Tech 2 and with guys having to go to Flag to do more updated training and whatnot. The staff members
were
refusing to go because they were like, I'm not signing another 5-year contract. And so they actually, in the last few years, said, no, you don't have to. You don't have to re-sign a new 5-year contract if you just come to Flag and do this little short Golden Age Tech 2 thing. So that's how they got out of it on the recent thing. But back in the day when I was doing this, when I first started, it was very rigid. That's how it was.
Well, yeah, it's like the phrase, they kept moving the goalposts. So you think you have a year done on your staff contract, you go training, it's like, no, now you have 5 years again.
That's right, and that would be a major issue that you would have to handle a person on before you could send them off for full-time training. They'd be like, damn, I got to do another 5 years. I don't think I want to do that. And you'd have to do a whole sales job. And I handled so many people on this. It's just, you know, over the years when I was in the Sea Org and stuff, because I was responsible for sending a lot of people to Flag for full-time training from my position when I was in the Sea Org. And so I handled, you know, did a lot of sales jobs on this.
You convinced them that, it's okay, you know. Well, yeah, if you're theoretically then, if you keep getting trained while you're on staff, you'll never get off staff. So why not a billion years, 5 years, 20, why not a billion?
Yeah.
What persuaded you to make this big jump from staff member to Sea Org member?
Well, the story goes that I actually sort of sold myself on it. And what happened was I had been on staff for a number of years, about 7 years at this point, it was close to the end of 8 years. And it was the end of 1994, and I was going down for the I had achieved the state of clear as a staff member, and I was going and doing what's called the solo auditor course, which was the course you do to train to learn how to audit yourself so you can then do the OT levels. And I was going down to Los Angeles for that, and it wasn't considered full-time training. I wasn't going down there all day, every day. I was just going down there on the weekends. And while I was down there at AOLA doing the course in the Sea Org environment, and I was reading these L. Ron Hubbard books, and, you know, he was talking about responsibility and taking full responsibility and wanting to, you know, be total cause over life, you know, matter, energy, space, time, life form, et cetera, et cetera. And I got kind of bedazzled by all of that. And not really having any idea what I was really signing up for, I walked over to the Sea Org recruiter office, you know, with this big head of responsibility. You know, I wanted to be responsible, right? And I always had a huge help button, you could say. You know, I always wanted to help. I really, really, that's what kept me on staff all those years, and that's what I wanted to do. So,
well, sure, and I think most people have goodwill and they want to help.
Exactly, and Scientology takes advantage of that. And so I, you know, I'd already been recruited 4 times unsuccessfully, so I already had a good idea of what they were going to tell me. And this time I just had sort of, you know, sold myself on it, really on that point of wanting to take more responsibility, as Hubbard put it. And so I walked into the recruiter's office and they were like, "Whoa, dude." And I said, "Yeah, I've been thinking about this and I think it's the right thing for me to do." And see, the thing that, one other thing about this is, as a staff member in Santa Barbara, because I was never making any money ever as a staff member,
right,
I had to work a full-time job, 40 hours a week, and work in the organization. And they, you know, it's volunteer status, but they don't treat you like you're a volunteer. They demand that you be in the organization working for at least 40 hours a week and this sort of thing. So I was already working 2 full-time jobs all day, all night, and weekend. Right.
Yeah, if you're doing 80-hour weeks and working weekends,
yeah,
you know, the jump to Sea Org, you can get your minder on 80, 90 hours.
Exactly. It really didn't seem like that big of a leap for me in terms of the volume of amount of hours a week I'd be working.
Well, no, it wasn't. But you raise a point I do not want to go past.
Yeah.
When you're on staff in Scientology and they're not paying you enough to live on, you have to get what they call a WOG job, or
right,
what they call moonlighting.
That's
moonlighting.
That's right. Moonlighting. Yep.
And this has always completely baffled me, because if I'm going to be a volunteer full time for some church 40 hours a week, they should pay me enough to live on, you know, get an apartment, you know. And when I was younger, I did religious volunteer services as a Christian, and my expenses were always paid. If there was lodging or transportation, it was just expected that the church would pick it up.
Yeah, not
because
that's Scientology. not when you're church staff.
No, but this is the thing about the church.
Yep.
Just to digress for a minute.
Yeah, yeah.
Whenever there's a disaster, earthquake, some tragedy, the Church of Scientology wants to send out its volunteer ministers.
So they say, yeah.
Yeah, to the scene. Well, usually it's to go out to some disaster for a photo op.
Yeah, exactly.
But the point is, it's not humanitarian. The volunteer ministers have to pay their own way.
Exactly.
And this is how the church gets $1.5 billion that we know about. It's like, we will not pay your expenses, Chris Shelton. We will not pay anyone's expenses. You pay your own expenses. We went 40 hours a week free, and you can work another 40-hour job to support yourself.
Exactly. And you're made to feel guilty about the fact that you aren't spending more time in the church working. You know, every waking hour, you're actually actively made to feel bad about that.
Yeah, and they will make you feel wrong.
Yep.
You're not dedicated enough. You're not doing enough.
That's right.
So
they call it being a dilettante.
Really?
Yes, based on a Hubbard policy about indicators of – the policy letter is called Indicators of Orgs, and there's a section in there subtitled Dilettantism, and Hubbard calls a dilettante one who only engages idly in some pastime, not as a serious, not with a serious professional viewpoint.
But wait a minute. Wait, how could you work 40 hours a week for free and be a dilettante?
Well, this is how it gets run on, at least how it was run when I was a staff member, is you got to be in the organization to do your study, and you got to be in the organization because we need you for this activity, or it's Thursday morning and, you know, what do you mean you can't come in to supervise this completion? We need the statistic before Thursday at 2. So Thursday morning, you have to bend your schedule if you have a day job, you know, to come in to get that stat up, you know, this kind of thing. And this,
but people at your day job, you're always taking off. They know you're in the Church of Scientology.
Yeah.
And I mean, I guess back in the 80s, you know, in some ways, a job might be more flexible than nowadays. But the church sounds like it's slave driving.
Well, it was there was pressure. Let's put it that way. There was a lot of pressure. And this was in Santa Barbara, which was a small, struggling org. I mean, this was not the Sea Org, you know.
Well, no, you're like in the backwater up there in beautiful Santa Barbara. So they went. So you're a dilettante because you're only putting in 40 hours.
Yeah, basically, it was this sort of thing gets run on everybody in Scientology. If you're not flat out full time 24/7, then you're a dilettante. You know.
Well, now, Hubbard had another word that I think is very, very funny. Thiti-weedy. What is thiti-weedy?
Well, thiti-weedy is a slightly different thing. Thiti-weedy is more of a case thing, and that is a person who is sweetness, and he describes it as sweetness and light. Nobody everywhere ever does anything wrong, and it's all beautiful. It's very Pollyanna, you know, everything's great and everything's wonderful, and aren't we all nice? And sweetness and light is not considered a good thing in Scientology.
Well, no, because it's a deadly serious activity,
right.
Scientology.
Exactly.
So getting back to the deadly serious activity that is the Church of Scientology, you, Chris Shelton, are only putting in 40 hours, so you're a dilettante.
I just wanted to say that to establish the mindset that I was in when I was thinking about taking more responsibility. It was from the viewpoint that what I had been doing wasn't enough, and I.
So you're judging yourself.
Oh, totally. After 8 years of this, you definitely are running it on yourself in your head, you know.
No, but you're judging yourself against the baseline that L. Ron Hubbard has set up of total devotion.
Exactly.
And what I wanted to note here is within a cult, isolation is a key part of it. They want you to immerse yourself in the Word of God or the Scripture or the text.
That's right.
Full immersion, full study, and you should also be there whenever the doors are open.
Exactly.
When I was in the Christian church, my pastor used to say, you should be here whenever the doors are open. That meant Sunday morning service, Sunday evening service, Tuesday Bible study, Thursday home Bible study, and any other events. Usually there was a Saturday, a work day, where you went down and cleaned the church.
Mm-hmm.
And the most dedicated of us, and I was certainly one of them, we were there any time the doors were open. When you weren't there, it was expected that you would read the Bible at least 1 hour a day. And this is what separated the sheep from the goats in the Christian church, or at least the one I went to. If you were not reading the Bible 1 hour a day minimum, you were a dilettante.
Mm.
So our threshold was much lower than yours, because I could get away with Bible reading for 1 hour.
Right. I was just thinking to myself, wow, if that was all we had to do, that would be, you know, slack.
Yeah,
you know.
No kidding. I was kind of slacking up compared to 40. So you go down to L.A., and they had to – when you walked in the Sea Org recruitment office and said, I'm here. They had to fall out of their chair because there's no reg cycle, right?
Pretty much there wasn't. Within 10 minutes, I was signed up and I was being sworn in. And it took.
Oh, how do they swear you in? Do you put your hand on a book, or what's swearing in?
You basically recite the code of a Sea Org member. There's, I think it's 19 points or something like that, 18 different points, you know. I promise to, you know, uphold and forward and carry out command intention. You know, I promise to, you know, uphold the dignity, honor, and integrity of the Sea Org, you know, all these different points, right? And
right.
You quote unquote swear to these things by reciting all of them with your right hand up, and you know, you got the code there in your hand, and somebody kind of walks you through it, you know.
You're reading from, okay, so you're a sworn member of the Sea Org.
That's right.
You're there. Now, did you replace yourself on your old job, or do they just call Santa Barbara and go, hey, we got Chris Shelton now? I mean, what does Santa Barbara do now that you're gone, or did you tell them? Or?
Oh, yeah, no. I definitely had to be replaced. And, in fact, here's the thing on that is, you know, there's a lot to say about this, but basically I did get it. I got it done right for me. That's an exception, not the rule.
But you're a by the book kind of guy.
Well,
right?
Well, I am. But also, I was holding down so much in Santa Barbara from my position that if I had left with no replacement, it quite literally would have collapsed the delivery of Scientology in Santa Barbara. And I'm not trying to like pump up my importance. I'm just saying I was on a key position where I was supervising the delivery of the purification rundown, I was supervising the delivery of the auditing, and I was supervising courses personally.
So you're a key player.
I was a key player, and it took 6 months between the time I signed up for somebody to come and work out the replacements and then get me out of there. And the replacements, usually it's a one-for-one, but in my case, there were three people who replaced me so that I could go. And Santa Barbara was very happy with the whole thing, and so then I arrived to Los Angeles.
Okay, so you're sworn in.
Yep.
Do they what happens? So you're sworn in, then what are the next couple steps? Like, what are your first 24 to 72 hours in the Sea Org?
Basically,
first couple of days.
You do what's called routing in, where they put you on a routing form, and you see a bunch of different people and do a bunch of steps like security, and they go through your stuff and they make sure you're not bringing anything, you know, any contraband or anything onto the base. And then you get sent up to the berthing spaces, and all your stuff is basically, you know, all you're allowed to bring with you is like a suitcase or two. I mean, you can't be bringing furniture and stuff like that.
Oh, no, it's like a toothbrush,
yeah,
you know, change of underwear, like bare minimum. So you get assigned a bunk. Was the berthing crowded? Is it as crowded as everyone says?
It was double high bunks when I was on the EPF, the Estates Project Force, which is the thing that they assign you to start with.
Now, does that mean four bunks?
No, it was two.
Just
high.
Two?
It was double bunks.
Okay. Oh,
yeah,
okay.
Sorry.
So
it was regular sized bunk beds.
Set of bunk
beds.
Yeah.
Now, these rooms actually got worse years after I was in the Sea Org. But when I first arrived in 95, it was regular sized bunk beds in the room that I was in. Now, here's the other thing, though. They take pains to try to make the EPF spaces less crowded and horrific than the regular dorm spaces that the crew have, because this is.
Okay, now let me stop you
yep.
there, Chris. EPF,
yes.
Just so people, when you sign into the Sea Org, it's Estates Project Force.
Yes.
This is like Sea Org for beginners. This is your introduction, indoctrination.
Yep. That's right.
Okay, so they try to make the EPF berthing nicer.
They try to, yeah. I mean, it's all a slop heap, but they try to make it not so horrible, because you know you walk in there and you're still in a position where the day you walk in you could just turn around and walk right back out.
So they don't want you running off.
No.
When you see what it's really like.
Exactly. So.
So a little bit of a honeymoon period,
yeah,
like it,
yeah.
It's kind of a slop heap, but not as bad as the real slop
exactly.
heap.
Exactly. So.
That's horrible. But, you know, look at this.
It's how
like
it is.
look at what you got to put up with. I'm going to give you 90 hours a week.
Yep.
And I'll agree to live in a slop heap.
Yep.
Because I don't matter and the church matters.
Well, basically, you're all pumped up on the idea of dedication and honor and, you know, duty. And, you know, and it's not dissimilar to, you know, guys going off to war and everybody signs up and they want to go fight the good fight and they want to, you know, go do, you know, do battle with the forces of evil, you know. And that's your idea in your head for the first day or two, but then things start getting real.
So
and then you're
okay,
like,
so what happens after your when does the disillusionment hit you?
Oh, you know, within a few days you're kind of like, okay, here we go, you know. It's a little boot campish, you know. There's not people you know, necessarily yelling and screaming at you like drill sergeants. It's not that bad, but it's basically your day is 5 hours of study in a classroom, and then the rest of the time you're running around what they call on decks, which means you're like, if you was on a ship, there's decks to a ship, and you'd be running around
yeah.
on the ship doing work, like what they call messed work, right? It's not work like you're calling public to sell them books, or you're
– It's just physical work.
Physical work, that's right.
Yeah, painting, cleaning.
Washing
yeah.
dishes, you're cleaning spaces, you're raking leaves, you're, you know, this kind of thing. And that's your day, and you're divided into units, and you're supposed to have a unit leader, and the unit leader is a fellow EPFer, you know, and they're learning how to be a leader, and you're learning how to be a follower, and the whole idea is to kind of indoctrinate you into the lifestyle and attitude of the Sea organization, which is one of servitude, and you know, and the call to duty and that sort of thing. And when you're on your study, you are studying basic Sea Org issues, and there's a series of lectures called the Welcome to the Sea Org lectures where Hubbard...
Really? Welcome?
Yeah.
Welcome to the Sea Org?
Yep. And Hubbard gave those lectures to new Sea Org members back in like 1968 or 69. And now everybody who goes into the Sea Organization listens to them. And he explains some basics about ships and why it's a Navy-oriented activity, why did they choose that, and what's the attitude of a Sea Org member and that sort of thing. And interestingly, now that I'm sitting here thinking about it, the last lecture is about PR, which
Really?
Yeah, and I'm now sitting here thinking about that right now going, wow, that's an interesting, you know, interesting choice to put that on the basic Sea Org thing, because, of course, there's so much PR that goes on in Scientology and in the Sea Organization that I'm just realizing right now how that they just put it to you right from the beginning. You know, I think it's called it's a PRO world. It's a PR, you know, it's all about PR, you know, appearances and things like that.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because the fundamental, one of the fundamental concerns, and I would even use a bigger word, I would say preoccupation. One of the big preoccupations of Scientologists, in my experience, is PR. That's out PR. Don't do it. That's out PR. That's good PR. Let's PR them.
That's exactly my point. And in fact, it was, you know, for fear of bad PR that they tried to ruin my life when I came here to Minnesota, because I was being a bad representative of, you know, having been a Sea Org member, and then I left the Sea Organization and I came back here where people knew me, and it was going to be this big PR flap, you know, that I was here. And it was all about the PR. Nobody cared at all about me or anybody else connected with the thing.
Well, how about PR,
you know?
This is how I view it. What about genuineness and authenticity? Why do we need PR if we're genuine, authentic, and we're living what we're preaching?
Well, that's the thing. They're not living what they're preaching, and that's the entire duplicity of all of the Sea Organization and Scientology, is they are not practicing what they preach. If they were, then all that PR stuff would go by the boards, because they wouldn't have to be creating a facade of, you know, standardness and happiness and isn't everything wonderful. All that could go by the – all that PR fluff could just go away if they would really do what they say they do.
Yes, and let's dwell on this for a
yeah.
minute, because when I was in college studying theology – one of the things we concerned ourselves with in philosophy of religion was the authentic existential struggle.
Mm.
So it was understood at that level that Christianity was there was an existential struggle with your faith, with culture, with society, and there was certainly an earnestness, because if you were going to preach, and that was my life plan at one point, was to be a minister of the gospel.
Mm.
If you're going to preach, you're concerned with incarnating the virtues of Christ, of being authentic and genuine with the congregation, and really ministering Christ to them. And it's very genuine. Chris, I'll tell you this, there are phony Christians. I think most of them are good people, you know, the good Christians.
Sure.
So discounting the phony, you know, the religious charlatans, genuinely people with a religious commitment, you know, Jewish, Hindu, Muslim, Christian, are good people.
Oh, so
even if you don't,
same with Scientologists. For the most
yeah.
part, they're good people. You know,
but except when it comes to PR, there's some sort of preoccupation. I'm representing the church. I'd better put on a false face. I'd better lie. I'd better not tell the truth. We
yeah.
have to have good PR. And I think this has become so ingrained into the church that the fact it's indoctrinated to you as belonging to the Sea Org, that suddenly obligates you. Would you say PR is one of your primary concerns while on duty?
Well, absolutely. And it's in the code of a Sea Org member. You know, you promise to uphold, forward, and carry out command intention, but you also, as one of the code points is, you know, the furthering the image of the Sea Org, right? And maintaining this high image of the Sea Org, and that the image must not be tarnished, right? And they don't use that wording, but that's the idea, right? And anything that ever comes out as bad PR or potentially, you know, going to create a tarnished image of the Sea Org is always talked about behind closed doors, you know, is always like not for public consumption, right?
So is getting further off topic, and we'll go back to EPF, but
yeah.
Getting further off topic, there's a term PR flap.
Yep.
Hill 10, flapping flap.
Yep.
Are these PR problems that it's like sort of it's a fire and you got to go put it out?
Yes. And a Hill 10 is the worst kind. A PR flap could be anything. You know what I mean? A guy's out on a mission and he gets sick. I mean, that would be a PR flap, right?
Just really?
Oh, sure. Yeah, because in Scientology, when you're sick, it always means that, you know, you did something. You're suppressed and you've gone to the effect of it, which means you committed overts, which means basically it's your fault.
Let me stop you. So,
yeah.
out here in the regular world, if you get sick, it's like, oh, my colleague couldn't make the meeting. He came down with a cold. He's sick. Flu, whatever. Oh, okay, let's go on with the meeting. But in the church, like, we have a PR flap. We have a PR flap. Chris has a cold.
Well, specifically the point being that, like I said, if you sent the guy out on a mission, right? Like, so he was out in the world, or out in an org, an outer org. Like, let's say, you know, I went from Los Angeles, you know, out to, oh, I don't know, you know, Denver org or something, and I was out there getting some project done. In other words, I was on a mission. And then I get sick. Well, you know, that's not good image for the Sea Org, because the Sea Org are supposed to be the most standard, the most ethical, the most, you know, perfect people. And so, you know, they create this false persona of what a Sea Org member is supposed to be, where they can't really be human. They can't really just be people.
No, he or she must be Superman.
Yeah, exactly.
Superwoman.
So anything short of that becomes a PR issue.
Okay, now going back, rewind a little bit.
Yep.
So you're listening to the Welcome to the Sea Org tapes by L. Ron Hubbard,
yeah.
Commodore L. Ron Hubbard,
yes.
And he's making you mindful of your PR duties. Then after you listen to the tapes,
yep.
And you do deck work on the EPF, once you graduate the Estates Project Force, what was your first assignment?
I was put onto post straight away as the the post title was is a little bit cryptic, but it was the assistant technical aide for the Western United States. And basically all that means is I was the management executive for the Western United States, overseeing the delivery of all of the counseling and all of the classes or courses that were delivered in all of the churches in the Western United States, west of the Mississippi.
So you started with a pretty big executive position.
I did.
I mean, did that create envy in your other graduates of the Sea Org?
No.
Like
you
jump way ahead?
No.
Or they did go, ooh, glad I didn't get that.
No, there wasn't any of that, because when you graduate the EPF, nobody sees you. Like it's there's no, you know, no, it wasn't quite like that.
Okay.
No, it wasn't quite like that. It was just, you know, that was the post I was assigned, and I was, okay, here we go. And I, you know, and then I was up to my eyeballs in trying to figure out what the hell to do.
And when you so you're still at PAC base,
yep.
And you are assistant technical aid, Western United States.
Yep.
Do you have an office with a desk?
Not my own office, but I had a desk and an office and a telex machine and our computer that I would send telexes out on. And yeah, I was given a space.
Now, Chris, here's a question.
Yep.
When you take a job at a corporation, you really want to, when you're interviewing for a job, you tell them all the reasons you're good for the job.
Yeah.
But you also, in the back of your mind, you want to know, why did the other person leave? Why are you hiring? Was the person who left, who had your job previously, were they promoted, declared, kicked out, or did you even know?
There hadn't been somebody on that position for years. So, I don't know what happened there on that.
Well, how can they leave, like, we haven't had this position filled for years. So the good news, I guess, you don't walk into a mess, or is it like, do you walk into, like, you have to do the impossible overnight? What do you walk into?
Well, I did walk into a mess. It was also a big confusion. I walked into the middle of West U.S. management. I mean, oh, man, I'm telling you, this is a big subject. But basically, I walked into, you know, the commanding officer of the so there's some terminology here, but basically the division that ran all of the Western United States, right?
What's it called?
It was called the FOLO,
Now, what does FOLO mean?
Flag Operations Liaison Office.
So it's FOLO Western U.S.
Yeah. Okay. You know, it's a shame because Scientology is just so big on abbreviations that...
Oh, it's swimming in alphabet soup agencies.
It's totally crazy, right?
You know what's funny? As an aside, they go on the Church of Scientology and its writings in the past have gone on about alphabet soup agencies, CIA, FBI, IRS. And it's like the church has more alphabet soup agencies than anyone I've ever seen. It's like to even talk Scientology, you have to know like, oh, well, that's COCMON, WDC.
That's right.
Like I really had to get a dictionary years ago, and then I had to go on the internet. I had to get a tech dictionary and go on the internet to figure out what the acronyms mean.
Oh, yeah. And it takes you know, a year or two to get it all down to the point.
Okay, so you're in FOLO.
Anyway, I was in FOLO Western
U.S.,
which is basically a division of another acronym here of CLO West U.S. And, okay, if you could, like the entire management body for the Western United States is housed within the Continental Liaison Office, the CLO.
Okay, let me translate.
Yeah.
In a corporation, you have international management.
Yep.
You have continental management, so like the Americas or North America. Then you would have regional offices. So you were in a continental level called Continental...
The Continental Liaison Office.
Okay, so that's in charge of the United States?
In the Western United States.
Okay, Western U.S. And then you're at a regional level called FOLO West U.S.?
Well, no. The CLO is the regional office. It's the Western United States office. And there's so many different things in Scientology that they manage, right? There's individual field auditors, there's the Scientology missions, and then there's the orgs. I'm trying to be really simple about this, right?
Sure.
Every one of those things is divided out so that there's a little body or a division inside the CLO that manages that area, right? So there's somebody who's handling the field auditors, and then there's somebody else who's some other body that's dealing with the missions, and then there's another body that's dealing with the orgs, and that body that's dealing with the orgs, that division, is called the FOLO. They're just orgs.
Would it be fair to say that the Church of Scientology is a dense bureaucratic maze?
Yes.
Because I can navigate through a corporation. And, you know, when I was in corporate life, part of the problem was knowing how to navigate the maze.
Mm-hmm.
But this sounds like a dense corporate maze. So are you at a middle management position?
Yes, I was considered, I was in middle management. There's upper and lower middle management. I was in lower middle management.
Now, was the place a madhouse, or is that too strong of a word?
It was a confused place, and it was kept confused by the way that it was run. It didn't have to be that way.
So you have a dense corporate maze that's possibly not managed well, so there's a lot of confusion?
Yeah, possibly. There's no possibly about it. It was not managed well.
Okay.
Yeah, and it got worse and worse as the years went on.
Well, so what do? Do you just sounds like you're jumping in the middle of something very challenging, and you have to sink or swim.
That's exactly
literally
that's
overnight.
Exactly what it was like, and I was running to keep up and try to figure out what were the politics, what were the power positions, how does this all work? What's my job in the first place in this big machine, you know, how do my little cogwheel fit into this? What are my responsibilities? Because you're held responsible, you know, it's like you're responsible for it. And, you know, you could be responsible for something you didn't even hear anything about. And suddenly you're getting slapped around for it. And you're like, oh, my God, I didn't know anything about this. So you're running to catch up.
And you wouldn't unless you have a mentor to explain it. Now, corporate life, there's policy and rules you have to read and understand.
Yes.
Now, the other thing that you should know about corporate life is there's a whole set of unwritten rules, and you don't know you broke them until you broke them. And this isn't any bureaucracy. So there's like a tribal structure. There's unwritten rules. There's policy.
Yeah, that's what I was talking about. That's right.
You have to come up to speed fast.
Yep.
Because you have to produce stats.
Exactly.
And I don't care where you are. If you work, you're going to produce something, and you got to do it under pressure fast. So what do you have to do?
Well, the first things that I was jumping into were organizing, you know, the way Scientology is organized, I was basically overall in charge of Division 4 in all of the churches in the Western
What's
United
Division
States.
4?
Division 4 was the delivery of the auditing and the training. Right.
Well, that's a big deal. That's a big income stream for the church.
Well, yeah, it's the delivery of the actual services that they're selling. So it's very important, and that's why somebody wanted me on that post very badly, because they, you know, you need to see to it that the churches are exchanging with the public for what the public are donating for, which is why I'm kind of big now on the fact that the church doesn't exchange for all the money it's receiving these days.
No, and that's a great point you raise, Chris. And I said this simply, it's something I've done in my writings. Why would you deliver auditing? That's a lot of work when you could just take money for free.
Well,
I mean, seriously,
that's what it's evolved to now.
Well, yeah, you know? No kidding, because it's like it's a hassle to deal with people. You got to deal with ethics, deal blah, blah, blah. You're dealing with people and auditing and files and folders and all this bureaucracy. It's like if I'm David Miscavige, I might think, oh, I'll just take their money and give them a trophy and just, you know, let's cut to the chase.
Exactly.
Like,
that's what it's devolved down to. But when I got involved, I cut my teeth on the whole concept of exchange. You know.
Well, yeah, that's how the church was set up originally.
That's right.
You pay, you get audited, you know, you get something, you give something. So the doctrine of exchange is central.
Exactly.
Now you get a trophy in exchange. So anyway, you were in charge of Division 4 or working with Division 4.
That's right. And so I was overall responsible for that. And it was made clear to me right from the get-go that whether I knew about it or not, whether I was able to deal with it or not, I was responsible for everything that was going on in those Division 4s in all of those churches. In other words, anything going on with training or anything going on with auditing delivery, processing the counseling, right? That was my baby. And I was to get you know, orders issued down into the orgs to get them delivering whatever they were delivering, get them to deliver more, whatever level they were at, get more, because that's how Scientology operates, right?
So, yeah, increase the statistics.
That's right.
I got a question. This is sort of an obscure trivia question for you. Years ago, they made a big deal in auditing rooms about having standard hand cream.
Yeah.
You know, for the cans. It's actually a brand name. You can Google it for my listeners. Standard hand cream.
That's right.
And so an auditing room is set up a certain way with a meter and shares, standard hand cream, tissues.
Mm-hmm.
Now, your concern would go from auditors, case supervisors, the actual auditing room, standard hand cream. You were responsible for everything.
That's right.
And what kept you awake at night? What worried you most in those early days?
Well, one of the biggest problems that hit the lines early on and continued to be a headache for many years, in fact, sort of was something that just kind of kept coming back around, was getting auditors for AOLA, for the Advanced Organization of Los Angeles, getting them sent to FLAG for training, because you couldn't train the auditors that deliver the upper OT levels in Los Angeles. You had to send them to FLAG.
And these are Sea Org members.
And they had to be Sea Org members. That's right.
So to deliver the OT levels, they have to go to FLAG to be trained.
That's right.
And does Advanced Organization Los Angeles pay for that training?
Well, yeah. The pain, when you're internally in the Sea Org, nobody cares about any of that. Once you're in the Sea Org and it's all Sea Org members amongst Sea Org members, that's not really what's important. What's important is that you find an able, warm body that's qualified to go to FLAG, and you get him approved, replaced, and sent to FLAG. And
now, correct me if I'm wrong, Chris. Yep. I thought everyone wanted to be an auditor in the Church of Scientology.
No, not everybody wants to be an auditor. But the real problem wasn't whether they wanted to be an auditor or not. It was whether they were qualified to be an OT5 auditor, right? Which means
really,
yeah, which meant that they had to be OT already. Right, because you're not going to, you know, you don't want to send some guy off who's at the bottom of the bridge, no auditing at all. That's not going to work.
Well, now this is really a key point. You cannot deliver the OT levels unless you yourself are OT,
yep.
And if you're in the Sea Org, you're probably not going to go up the bridge.
Well, there were, yeah, exactly.
I mean,
exactly.
So therefore, how do you get auditors? I can see your problem.
Oh, and this was a tremendous problem that just kept going and going and going. And I mean, because AOLA was supposed to have 40 of these auditors. And
how many did they have?
That's a lot. They had, I mean, I think when I first went in on post, there were 9. And then we just needed more, and it was sort of a vague sort of thing. And then the golden age of tech happened less than a year after I was on post, because I went on post in summer 1995. And in May of 1996 is when the release of the golden age of tech first happened, and that changed everything. And in 1998, Miscavige issued a series of Inspector General Network bulletins, which was just basically orders that he issued. And he wanted 2 auditors for every auditing room that AOLA had. And AOLA had been renovated at that point and had like 20 auditing rooms. Therefore, there were supposed to be, you know, 39 or 40 auditors. And yet there were only, you know, 10 or 11 or something like that. And so we were tearing our hair out. I mean, we were having meetings until 3 in the morning trying to figure out who could go do this training. And this just went on and on and on. And it was made way more than my problem. It was made everybody's problem because it was such a problem, such a flap, such a situation.
Okay, Chris, if I'm following you, you are AOLA is 75% understaffed.
Yep.
There's a mandate from on high to bring it fully staffed.
Yep.
Help me out here. I'm not sure I'm following this part of it. Why can't you just grab 30 people and send them the flag to train them as auditors? If you're short, if you have 10 and you need 30, why can't you just take 30 people?
One, they have to be OT. 2, they have to be qualified for full-time training, which means they have to be a good study. They can't be a crappy student. In other words, they have to be able to sit down and do their courses and do them quickly. And not everybody can. Some people go on study and they just sit there and fall asleep. I mean, it's crazy.
Sure, yeah.
So they have to be a good student. They have to be qualified to go to FLAG, which means they can't have certain things in their past because not just anybody can go to FLAG for training. For example,
illegal?
Well, they can't be what?
I'm saying that some of them would be illegal.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. A bunch of people. Because,
what makes it illegal to go to FLAG?
Well, they can't have any suicide, attempts or problems or anything like that because FLAG is crazy about that.
Yeah, understood.
They have to be in the Sea Org, of course. They have to, you don't want a bunch of older people because, you know, then they're, you know, like they're 60 or 70 and then you're going to train them and then they're going to come back and be dead in a few years. So that's not going to work. So you want, you know, younger people.
Yeah.
And there was a whole slew of qualifications.
No, but look at this. When you start culling, you need a younger person, okay.
Yep.
You need someone who, without a big, you know, who's not a big ethics problem.
Yep.
Who's a good student.
Yep.
Who's already OT.
Yep.
So yeah, you really start narrowing your pool of candidates to hardly anybody.
That's right. And yet you're still being demanded to figure it out. And that's just why we'd have these meetings until 3 in the morning, until something could be worked out. And this just happened. This just went on and on and on.
Well, how did they work it out, or did they ever come up to full staff?
They never got the 40 that I know of. I think when I left, well, when I finally got off of this A-Tech-Aid post in 2003, ironically, it was getting one of these NOTS auditors, one of these AOLA auditors that finally set me over the edge and made me blow my post. I mean, this was just a bugbear on my – this was a monkey on my back for the entire time I was on this post, as I'm sure you can tell from the tone with which I talk about this. But I think they got a maximum. I think they got it up to 20 at one point.
Well, that's only 50% understaffed, but that's progress.
Yeah, exactly.
So,
and of course, the driving reason behind this is because, you know, in the entirety of the PAC base in Los Angeles, of the Los Angeles Sea Org complex there, the highest, you know, amount of money, the big money-making service you can sell there is those upper OT levels. So they wanted lots of auditors so that they could sell lots of that auditing so that they could make lots of money. It was all money driven.
Well, question, were the 20 auditors they had, were they kept busy full time?
No, they were not. In fact, a couple of them, I know for a fact, a couple of them are, you know, out full time, wandering around the Western United States trying to round up business because AOLA doesn't have enough business.
Well, now, wait a minute. This here's what doesn't make sense to me. Miscavige wants 40 auditors delivering OT levels, and yet he can't keep 20 busy.
This is the if you build it, they will come reasoning, which goes right along with, you know, why have these great big ideal orgs when they're empty.
Really?
Oh, yeah. It's the same. It's the same mindset because it's coming from the same guy.
So they think that just by having 40 people that all the auditors will be kept busy all the time.
Well, yeah, because then it's up to each individual auditor to get himself busy and productive, right? So he's going to get busy getting people to audit, and somehow this is all supposed to work. And it's just the biggest, most ridiculous thing you've ever heard of.
Well, not necessarily. It's not ridiculous in one way. And this is my perspective on it, Chris. If I'm a guy like Miscavige, I'm thinking in terms of how much cash I need to bring in.
Right.
So I'm thinking if I have 40 auditors instead of 20 and I can force them to book their schedules, I'll double the amount of money I'm making on AOLA. So I can infer that he's driving toward a cash number for that org.
Of course he is. That was my point in talking about why, out of all of the things that I would be getting heat for over all the years that I was in that position, why would those NOTS auditors, those AOLA auditors, keep being the number one thing that kept getting thrown at me? And it's because it was financially motivated.
They are the cash cows.
That's right. Every 12 and a half hours of auditing with one of those auditors will cost somebody $4,500 to $5,500.
Lord have mercy. That's a lot of money.
Yeah. Exactly.
My lovely wife, Karen De La Carriere, class 12 case supervisor, they used to charge $1,000 an hour or more for her services.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
$1,000 an hour.
That's right.
And what I want our listeners who have never been in the church to realize, you pay as you go, and you can pay $200 an hour or more depending on the level of auditor you get.
Mm-hmm.
So what my friend Chris is telling you is they're looking to put auditors in to just drive in the cash.
That's right.
But the problem is in the church, and again, let's expand the viewpoint. If I'm a public Scientologist, so you're the guy on Sea Org getting auditors, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, at the same time, the publics who would otherwise pay to go on OT levels are being regged for everything else. So we want money for IAS. We want money for ideal orgs. We want money for golden age of whatever.
That's right.
And this is why it's such a mess. It's like competing departments in the Sea Org are competing for donations from public members.
Mm-hmm.
So one time I did a count, and I have it, I'll put it up on Tony's blog, but there's like 40 different things I counted when I stopped that are competing for money in the Church of Scientology. And then literally it goes into libraries, books, CST, archive project, and you just go down the list. So you as an executive, you have people in the Sea Org competing for the dollar, right?
Mm-hmm.
Did that ever cut across your lines? Someone saying, I can't audit because I'm broke?
I can't audit because I'm broke?
No, what I'm saying, let me rephrase it. There's publics, you're expected to fill auditor position so the public can come in and get audited on the OT levels,
that's
correct?
Right. That's right.
Okay, now, the other catch-22 is that those publics you think will come in and get auditing from your auditors might be broke because they've donated to 20 other things.
Oh, sure. Oh, yeah. That was a constant thing. Ironically, I actually ended up, after being on this funny you should mention this, because after being on this a tech aid position, and after I blew and, you know, took off and got the hell out of management, my next job was going into AOLA and being a registrar and signing people up and getting them to pay for these OT levels.
So you saw it from both sides.
Right.
The one thing,
that's right.
You are the machine with the auditors, and on the other side, you're feeding the machine.
Exactly.
Now, having done both, which is harder to do?
Oh, it was a lot harder to be in management. Management was a much, much harder thing to do. It was easier to get money from people than it was to, you know, get personnel or manage organizations.
You know, it's interesting because you're in two different key slots there, managing and putting auditors in shares versus putting publics in shares.
Mm-hmm.
Because obviously people will pay for auditing. They have some spiritual reason they want to get audited for, okay?
Mm-hmm.
But they don't know when a public member of the church goes in for auditing, they don't know all the behind-the-scenes stuff, and I don't even know if they care.
No, they don't. I mean, why should they? That's not their problem, you know, and they're not made to care. I mean, they just have to pay up so they can go in session and do those wonderful, miraculous OT levels.
And that's what's pretty remarkable is I've paid my money, I'm here, audit me.
Mm-hmm.
And this to me seems one of the fundamental disconnects in the church. The public Scientologist, he or she may not realize the human suffering of the Sea Org.
No. Or they don't. And again, it comes back to actually coming a little full circle back to this PR point, because that, you know, the suffering and the injustices and the various things that go on with the Sea Org members, that's kept behind closed doors as much as possible.
So yeah. you make an excellent point that I want to cover in the next part of this.
Yeah.
We're coming up on our hour break. Because you must do PR, keep PRN, you meaning all Sea Org members,
yep,
must keep PRN, the public doesn't know what you go through.
No, they don't. They don't really understand. Some of them think they do, but until you live it, you really don't.
That's just appalling. So you have this disconnect.
Yep.
You can be in an auditing room, then there's a pre-clear or a PC being audited and the auditor.
Mm-hmm.
And they don't know about each other's universes.
No.
In fact, the public member gets the session and then gets to go home.
That's right.
The Sea Org member is home, and so you go back at the end of the day, finally, to birthing.
Yeah, you cross the street.
You go into a bunk, and you may have made $200 or $400 an hour for the church or $1,000 an hour for the church,
right,
whatever,
mm-hmm,
and you're getting $50 a week or less.
Exactly.
Chris, let's leave it on that for this hour.
Sure.
You're making the church an enormous amount of money, and you get $50 a week.
Exactly.
And when we come back, I do want to get more into the OT levels,
okay,
the Advanced Organization of Los Angeles, and what goes on a real nuts and bolts level, because people love details.
Sure.
I've got so many more questions. Chris, we appreciate the hour you've spent with us, and we're going to pick it back up. For Surviving Scientology Radio, this is Jeffrey Augustine, and as always, we'll be in very good touch.